So here's my solution. I define the function search, which is the only function I'm going to run in the end. It's like the main routine. And to check cells once they're expanded, so I don't expand them again, I define an array called closed, so the same size as my grid. And it has two values, 0 or 1. 0 being it's still open, 1 meaning it's being closed. You could also use booleans. So this over here assigns an array of the same size as the field grid. I initialize the starting location as checked, and I assign the coordinates to x, y, and a g value of 0, and my initial open list is going to be this one element of my initial coordinates and the g value of 0. So far what I've done is I've defined an array called closed of the same size. All the check marks are not there except for the ones in the left corner, and this is my starting location on my open list right over here with a g value of 0. Inside my code, I use two flags. One is found, which will be true when the goal position is found, and one is resign, which will be true if I don't find a goal position and I've explored everything. The second one will be the case when my open list just turns empty without finding the goal. That's really important for the case where I can't find a path to the goal. Those print commands were the ones I used for debugging. You can look at them. They print out the existing open list, nothing else. But here's the code. I repeat the following while I haven't found a path to the goal, and I haven't proved that the problem is unsolvable. So both found and resign are false. If my open list is empty, there's nothing to expand, then resign is true and I print fail. So this is one of the two terminating conditions. You can convince yourself there's no path from S to G. We will expand every node on the left side of the barrier until we finally run out of nodes to expand, at which point the open list will be empty and our search failed. If there's still elements on the open list, the else case comes into place. And here's how I remove the element with the smallest g value. I use the list sort function, which sorts elements in increasing order from the smallest g value up. And now I want to pop the element with the smallest number. Unfortunately, pop pops at the end. So I just reverse the list and then pop the element with the smallest g value from that list. There's a little bit of a trick here. It's not very elegant. It's also not very efficient, but it does the job for now. That here gets me the element with the smallest g value. And for that, it's important that the g value comes first in each of these triplets. That's why I put it first, before the x and the y. I then assign the three values to x, y, and g, which is my expansion. Again, g is the first, x and y are second and third. And now I'm in the position to test whether I reached the goal. So if x is the goal 0 and y is the goal 1, I'm done. I call found equals true. I print out this triplet, and that gives me the triplet over here. So this print next over here is this triplet, and that's the one I was looking for, asking you about printing exactly the solution over here. Now, if I'm not done yet, then here's the interesting case, and that's the meat of what I'm programming. I'm going through all the possible actions. There's four of them. Delta is an array of four different actions. I apply the action to x and y with this addition over here by applying the corresponding delta vector to construct x2 and y2. If x2 falls into the grid and y2 falls into the grid, and x2, y2 is not yet checked, which is tested by this field called closed, and the grid cell is navigable, there's no obstacle here. If all these things are correct, then I found an expansion that I now add to the open list. I increment the cost from g to g2 by adding 1 in this case, cost is 1. And then I append the new triplet g2, x2, y2 to my open list. And I check the coordinate x2, y2 so I never expand it again. That is the recursion. Put differently, when I drew down this element over here, for example, I looked at possible ways the robot could move. In my software, this means the robot has to stay inside the grid and the grid cell has to be unoccupied, which is this test over here. I also checked whether there's already a check mark at a cell, which is this test over here. And if this was true, I added the new element to my open list with the new g value incremented and the new coordinates. And that's exactly happening over here. I increment the g value and I add it with the new coordinates. This is the key of your search algorithm. The only remaining thing now is that I call the search routine that prints me out this thing over here.